Meet me on the moon soon as you can. In the middle of the sky, you and I, riding on a cloud, soft as you please. We can sail upon the breeze.
MIT has been very successful at drawing people from 100 countries. Yeah. And we've been doing it for a long time. Yeah. In the 30s, we brought, for the first time, people from many different walks of life and many different countries and cultures. Our first Nobel winner was a man who spoke with a strong accent of Italy. And so we've had experience with that question as it relates to ethnicity. Mm-hmm. Why can't we do the same thing when it relates to race? And specifically African Americans. And I have worried and thought about that question. And there is no easy answer. It's the, in a sense, the American dilemma. Yeah. As Myrdal said, of assuming somehow deep in the mindset that we can't make progress, and so we see defeat and we don't try hard enough. As you and I have talked about this over the years, Clarence, yeah. I think it lies in the heart of each of us, but the institution has to set a frame where that kind of activity is encouraged, where people are promoted, where people are brought up and promoted, encouraged early. We do some of that, not nearly enough. I've told you I've been disappointed at our progress, and I really mean that, because I think the nation has to look to, I believe there's, I say this now on short thought, that there are bridge institutions. Wouldn't it be great if MIT had a reputation for being a bridge institution?
That's right.
We have grown college presidents. Why can't we grow great individuals who are underrepresented, let's call that. And so, if you look for an answer, I don't have one for you. But I want to keep working on it the rest of my life, however long it is.
Yeah.
And if you have your conference, I'll attend it.
Well, I certainly wouldn't have it unless you could be there.
Clarence, I think that that leadership in that respect requires action, requires committing part of one's energy and time to doing something which will make a significant difference in the presence of underrepresented minorities, in the way in which they adjust to the institution, in their feeling part of the place. For me, one of the earliest and best examples was Professor Albert Hill, now long deceased. But Al, as associate department head in physics, set out to systematically bring black graduate students to that department, looking around, recruiting from the predominantly black colleges. And in a way which was unheralded at the time, which he did because he knew it was the right thing to do, he made a real difference in that department. The folks who were involved in starting the MITES program, the second summer program, the people who were involved way back in 1969 in creating Project Interphase as a transitional program for some underrepresented students who are coming to MIT. Part of it is action, doing something which makes a difference. Leon Trilling in AeroAstro is another example of someone who took actions, like Al. Part of it is, I think, also the attitude one brings to one's daily task. This institution, over the last 35 years, has become much more representative of the society than it was in my early days at MIT. It's not there yet. That job is not done. But it is more representative, more a home, a satisfactory home to underrepresented minority people than it used to be. And that comes about by a change in attitude, which over a period of time changes the culture of the institution. Institutions like this have to change. If we don't change, the society is going to leave us behind. America in 2100, you and I won't see it, but America in 2100 is not going to be predominantly white society. And if the institutions don't evolve, they'll die. So beyond specific actions, things one can do and institutionalize, there is the need to recognize that the institution must change to reflect the society if it's going to continue to be vital. If it doesn't change, it becomes irrelevant. And that is a message which can come at any level in the institution. You've seen it come in this place from leadership at the top. Now, that kind of message and that kind of leadership does not necessarily lead directly to the changes that we're talking about, but it tries to establish a climate in which the importance of that is understood and in which it is seen as an institutional objective.
Flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh, 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 ooh.
The Blacks at MIT project is a really important thing to do, and I'm happy to be a part of it. In part because it's important that MIT know and the world know that we're here and that we have contributed in our, as all other groups. We don't want special treatment. We don't want to be ignored either, right? We simply want to be acknowledged for our accomplishments and for our experiences to be better understood. But also, we provide a window into the particular challenges of a group of Americans who have had to undergo, at least as a collective, a lot of hardships. For anyone questioning this importance, they should look at this project to get a better sense of what happens when you ignore human potential, when you make assumptions about who has potential and who doesn't based on appearance, right? Which has been much of our country's history. When you make decisions like that, the country loses. And this project shows that.